any situation we encounter in our work environment can be broadly classified into two categories, controllable and uncontrollable. Take for an example, an airline pilot. Once they take off, they switch on autopiloting. And then they take controls when they want to land. Strictly speaking, the entire process can be delegated to a computer with modern technology. So, as long as anything is controllable in your hands, you can delegate that responsibility even to a machine. Then the next question is, why do you require a pilot? You require a pilot in the event that if things get out of control. In an uncontrollable situation, the pilot's intervention is required. The same thing can be emulated into a work environment. The responsibilities can be delegated to the next level down as long as everything is controllable in their hands. But any controllable situation can spontaneously get transformed into an uncontrollable situation. For example, let's assume a situation that while a plane is flying, an engine catches fire. Now, that is a situation which needs the pilot's intervention immediately. So, that's where we need the pilot. Somebody has to handle that situation. Now, what can the pilot do? The pilot could be a very well experienced pilot with maybe 20 years of experience, but he has never had any experience in encountering a fire on board. So, then what can he do? The first thing he must do is, he must resort to the training that he got in handling a contingency of that nature. During his training period, he must have been definitely taught about how to handle such a situation. But if he knows of a pilot who has handled a similar situation in the past, that pilot's experience can be emulated to handle this situation. This is the difference between the clever man and the wise man. Clever man learns from his mistakes and his experiences. Wise man learns from others' mistakes and others' experiences. In August 2007, a China Airlines pilot had an emergency situation like that, a fire on board, and he landed in Taipei, in Taiwan, and evacuated 157 passengers within 3 minutes. And he also escaped. As they all got out of the plane exploded. Now, that's an experience that must be shared and even maybe simulated in all future training programs conducted for the pilots as to how he did it. So, anyone experiencing a similar situation, they can emulate that knowledge in to handle such contingencies. In such contingencies, three things must happen. The first thing is, somebody who is capable of managing the situation must evolve as the leader to handle that situation. And the leader there means is, need not be the person who is most authoritative, but who is most capable of handling it. I can cite one small example, what was being told by one of my military students. As he was commissioned and posted to the war-affected areas in early 2000s, he was deployed by his commanding officer for an operation. He was leading a platoon. He was just out of the military academy with no battle experience. And they were advancing in two flanks. One was commanded by him and the other one was commanded by his well-experienced sergeant who was having about 20 years of experience in battlefield. And at one point, the enemy started firing mortars towards the camp they were operating out of. And it was, he said it was like a mortar rain. It's one after the other mortars flying, flying over their heads. And as the first mortar flew over his head, then he ordered his line to go down and take cover. Then his camp also started firing mortars in the direction where the mortar fire is coming. And he raised the head only after the mortar fire ceased to see that his sergeant was taking a break by smoking a cigarette and observing this as a fireworks display. Because the sergeant from his experiences knew that none of the mortars which were fired over their heads are going to fall into where they were. So that's where the experience matters more than the authority to handle uncontrollable situations. Because the best thing to do at a time like that is making joint decisions. The most authoritative person and the most experienced person discussing the issue and making joint decisions is the most appropriate in such a situation. The second thing they must do is they must keep the superiors informed at once to the best possible extent. There can be somebody handling the ground situation, but to the best possible extent, the superiors must be kept informed. To justify the second point, I want to cite an airline example once again. A crash took place over the Atlantic Ocean in 2009, and it was during the winter, and for some reason the instruments started malfunctioning, most likely attributable to snow accumulating on the its flaps. And the pilot was taking a break, and in the co-pilot seat was there was a rookie pilot, and the pilot seat was occupied by the co-pilot at that time because it was flying on this autopilot. And the plane started losing its elevation, and the pilot in control panicked, and he did exact opposite thing of what a pilot should have done to get the plane up to the right elevation. And at the last moment, when he couldn't do it any longer, he called the pilot, but it was too late. The last comment heard when the pilot entered the cockpit was, "Oh my God." And that was on the black box. So that's why, because in that uncontrollable situation, the pilot in charge didn't inform his superior. So that's the importance of, when you are handling uncontrollable situation, the importance of informing your superiors. Third point is, in such contingencies, you can use your power, authority, even your beliefs. If it is going to give you some inspirational support, and make sure that you accomplish the task of bringing the uncontrollability to controllability. To elaborate the inspirational support that I mentioned in the third point, Matthew Hayden, after setting the world's highest score for test cricket, he at the press conference said, "What made me break the world record is the cap I was wearing and the strap I was wearing around my wrist." The cap had been sent to him by a well-wisher on the day he got selected to the Australian cricket team.